trying to convey to people. But there is a lot of paradoxes out there. Like, for example, I strongly believe that universal full prosperity is the solution to freedom. This is the path to freedom. You've got to, let's face it, if you're not financially free, which means rich, prosperous, which may have nothing to do with money, need not. Prosperity need not have nothing to do with money, because a state of mind often is a sense of prosperity, a sense of freedom, okay? But in order to be free, and in order to find happiness, happiness comprises a lot of components. If freedom is one of those components, there's a lot of components involved in being free. Free has a lot of definitions, but absolute freedom means you include financial freedom. So while I strongly believe in it, I don't preach the prosperity gospel. I'm not the guy telling you, just go out, make a lot of money, and, you know, I know you can do it, and rah, rah, rah. You know what I mean? I'm not one of those kind of people. Okay, because I couldn't enjoy it. Sure, I could say, yeah, I mean, I can, I can toy with the idea of living a more luxurious life. But in all honesty, if I can't enjoy it, which I know I can't, being who I am, being the person I choose to be, let's say, I couldn't enjoy at this point in the paradigm of the establishment reality, where we've got poverty increasing, people dying out in the cold, out on the streets, where we've got the wealth and income disparity growing. I'm not going to enjoy it. I don't want him. I've got too much already. I'm a spoiled brat. Okay, that's the way I feel. I feel like I don't know if I can stand before God and justify all the possessions that I have. And if most people could look at my personal finances, they would laugh. Literally, most people would probably laugh. They'd say, that's absurd. That's ridiculous. It's preposterous to think that you're rich and that God's going to hold what you have against you. In terms of your prosperity, and you didn't give enough to the poor. That's not how I feel. It's not. I feel compunction. I feel guilt about what I have. That's the honest to God truth. But I can also understand why people it's very alluring and enticing, the prosperity and driving a brand new beautiful car and doing whatever. I live in this extravagant, profligate lifestyle. I get it. Taking cruises, tours, live wherever you want in the world, anytime you want. I get it. Buying nice Italian suits and French suits, whatever. I get it. I get it. I get it. I get it. But I don't want it. Not yet. Maybe someday. When I see this worm turn, when I see this ship turn, when I see homelessness drying up, poverty drying up, when I see the wealth and income disparity drying up, not from taking from the haves, not from redistribution of wealth, but by allowing the have-nots to simply have. You see, we can all have, and the system won't break down. That's a matter of fact. And even if the system would break down, it's not your problem. That's in God's hands. It's none of your damn business. If God says, this is how I want it to be, this is the paradigm that's coming, then we just need to listen to him and prepare ourselves for it, for universal prosperity. So that's a paradox. While I believe fully in prosperity, people say, well, why don't you just go out and make a lot of money and shut your damn mouth? I'd love to shut my damn mouth. I'd love for the worm to turn. Okay, I'm like a deer panting for water in the desert that's lost its way. I feel like I'm bound to die in this morass. Okay, it's evil, man, and I'm so tired of it. I'm not even affected by it. Okay, rent isn't an issue for me. Okay, it's not. I've got a very low cost of living. I'm a very spoiled, lucky guy, I guess, you know, so I've got enough. My sense of security is through the roof, okay? So you understand that I'm on the up and up with people. I just want things to get better. I want the worm to turn, for crying out loud. I'm desperate for the worm to turn for other people. My daughters are out there paying rent for them alone. I'm speaking out for the other generation. They can look at my videos and they're going to say, well, this guy spoke the truth. I don't have anything more radical to say. I hear guys like Paul Joseph Watson, you know, they're getting, you know, shut down from Google or YouTube, or they're getting censored and getting suspended. And, you know, your Cernoviches, your Roger Stones and Alex Jones and this guy from England, what's his, Tommy something or other. I can't remember his name. But he's very outspoken about Islamic matters and all this refugee and immigration stuff. And remember, who's causing all these problems? Remember, this is, they're doing it. These evil people at the top, they believe it or not, they will start wars for profit. You think, no, nobody's that evil. Nobody's that diabolical. Yes, they want the refugees to come in. It's a deflection. It's a diversion. It's a distraction. It's chaos. It creates a clash of civilizations. So yes, they want it. It puts an artificial demand on essential human needs. So it's a justification. Oh yeah, well no wonder rents are going up. We're bringing in all these immigrants and refugees from these war-torn areas. And you don't want them? You lack compassion. What does your Bible say? What does it say about the foreigners? But they're causing it. Their religion is diabolism, and they're very devout. They're murdering children to do this. Some people will say, oh, no, it's all about cheap labor and all this. That's another perk. I'm not saying that's not involved. They like to kill more than one bird with a stone. Many, many, many birds if they can. But who's behind it? What is the motivation? Yes, it gives them a pretense, a pretext. No, well, no wonder your housing prices are going up. No wonder the welfare system's taxed out. With these people, they got a right to leapfrog, and they get, you know, these are war-torn people. I mean, they got families and children. They've got to take care of them. So they get priority. You know, you Native American citizens that were born here, take a back seat. You're a single guy. You're a woman without children. Go. Do the earth a favor. Go die out in the cold under a bridge somewhere. Please, we don't have enough welfare to give you. We've got these refugees we got to take care of. So you want to quote the Bible to me about the refugees, the immigration issue? Is somebody going to do that? I saw that on Tommy, I still can't remember his name. Tommy Robinson, that's his name. But, you know, these guys, and I don't have to worry about that. Everything I have to say, I say. I get everything off my chest. Any steam I got to blow off, I do it. I just don't have to cuss. I don't have to sound condemning or anything. I believe in living at peace with my enemies as much as possible, winning them over as possible. This is in the Bible. Love your enemies. Try to win them over like a puppy dog. I'm like a puppy dog with an olive leaf in my mouth. Mm-hmm. Please come over. Please come over. I'm over here. I'm swimming in the nice, clean, pure, clean, clear water. Get out of the muddied and bloodied water of these elitist scumbags. Come out. Come on over here. Join me over here. That's what I'm saying. That's why it's as radical. I don't have a violent bone in my body. You know, I'm a wannabe pacifist. I admit that, yeah, I'm not perfect yet. I've got tendencies. I've got propensities. I mean, I came face to face with a pedophile. I saved my daughters from being molested. And it was just by chance. It was just an instinct. I followed a hunch. I had to get in the guy's face. I said, you know what? If I find out you touch Lisa or my kids again, the kids, okay, because he was with my wife, my former wife, and daughters, and I just got in his face, right in his face. Bigger guy than me, older guy than me, and I told him the score. And yes, I was trying to trigger him, and guess what? I triggered him. He ran away, and he got a baseball bat, all this stuff. It turned out the guy was a pedophile. He was convicted, and he's doing the rest of his life in jail because he tried to put hits out on the DA, my former wife, and everything else. It felt good. It was kind of a self-righteous moment. But, you know, I would love the guy to take a swing at me, even with the bat. Okay, I would have been all up. He probably would have been, you know, I probably would have killed the guy. And it would have been self-defense, really, because everybody was just, it was apartment complex. They heard the yelling, the commotion, and they come out to see what was going on. But nothing ever happened. But it felt kind of good. I got to be honest with you. So I'm, in a sense, I'm a wannabe pacifist, but I don't believe in violence and I hate it. I don't ever want to kill anybody. I don't want to hurt somebody accidentally, much less on purpose. I don't even want to hurt their feelings. I mean, after all, I say to myself, to what avail? What profit is it? I don't see it. But, you know, I respect the warriors out there that have fought for the good fight, believing what they're doing. And if you're remorseful of killing somebody and you think it was wrong, you have compunction, that's good. You're supposed to. But you really, God in all his infinite wisdom, really didn't give us the power to make somebody not exist anymore. You can put them into the big sleep, like it's called, maybe. But you can't really make them not exist. I mean, we go through this door into another door, okay? That's it. Even the wicked live forever. They just live in a different place. So everything's forgivable, even murder. Remember, Moses killed a guy. The Apostle Paul, that wrote 2/3 of the New Testament Bible, he was hunting down Christians and persecuting them and having them killed because he believed that they were evil. They were blasphemers for calling Jesus the Son of God. But yet we're all children of God, and God's not offended by that idea. He wants us to emulate him. And if we can't know him, then we can't emulate him. So he makes himself very clear, his nature, his character, his personality.